another video. If you haven't, go ahead and like, comment, and subscribe so you can be a part of the Happily Ever Turners family. We're so excited about this video. Today, we're going to talk about a topic that we're very passionate about. We love manhood, womanhood, singles, dating, engagement, marriage, all things in between. We absolutely love it. And today we're just going to talk about things that helped us as we were engaged, getting ready to get married.
Yeah.
So again, this video is going to be our journey to the altar, 10 things we did to prepare for marriage. And let's jump right in.
Yeah, so we got some notes here, you all. We're just going to kind of go down the list. Number one, praying and fasting was the number one thing that we did at the beginning of our marriage. We wanted to make sure that we were just able to articulate God's vision for our marriage, our family, and our ministry. Because I think that's very important to have a good foundation for your marriage.
Yeah. No, that's really good. We covered all that. We prayed, we fasted for everything. And I think that was important in the beginning stages because we need to have a solid foundation. And then number two is we had hard conversations and we talked about expectations.
Oh, yeah.
And this one right here, he made sure his expectations were known, okay? And I was like, sheesh. But no, it's okay. But no, we had that conversation. Hey, what do you expect? What does life look like together? What do you like? What do you dislike? What is your pet peeve? Of course, you're going to learn those things while you're dating, while you're courting. Of course, you learn things. But then you got to think about you're going to live together. You're going to do life together. You're going to be around this person more hours than you were before when you were just dating. Yep. So we had to, have those conversations about stuff that really irks our nerve and just standards. Like, for example, Andre is a neat freak, okay? And I'm just an organized mess, but he's a neat freak. But he was able to articulate that and let me know, like, hey, the standard is the house need to be show ready at all times, okay? And he's like a model. You know, like when you go into an apartment or a studio or whatever, and it's just everything is neat and in place. That's Andre. And he was able to have that. And then the hard conversations, we talked, just about everything, like stuff that went on in our family, about finances, all different like hard conversations you need to have about attitude problems, things you need to get delivered from. What other hard conversations did we talk about?
We talked about finances.
Definitely, yes. Talked about finances. Talked about debt. Yes.
Because you marrying, they're dead.
Yes.
So we were able to have an honest conversation. But I did want to say, because you said something really good a minute ago, trust, I think, has to be built for you to be able to have conversations. And then transparent, if your relationship is built on transparency in the beginning stages, a lot of that comes easy, as you all do life together. You're able to have those hard conversations. You're able, when times get rough, you're able to, speak out.
Yeah. Another hard conversation we had, we talked about conflict.
Oh, yeah.
And communication. We talked about exactly how are we going to respond in conflict? How long do you get to be mad? Like, it ain't no, you get to sleep on the couch. It ain't no, you get to shut me out for 24 hours. Like, we talked about what was actually our standard. And we came up with, hey, if we have a disagreement, because I'm the type of person, I want to talk about it right then and there. I don't want to let it fester. I don't want to do none of that. Andre, he needs to decompress. He needs to process it. He needs to pray about it. He needs to woosah. He needs to do all that. So we came to agreement that, okay, hey, you got 4 hours. Whatever you need to make out up in that 4 hours, and then we're going to talk about it. We're not going to let the next day go by. We ain't going to let days go by. We're not going to harp on it. After we have a conversation about it, we're going to get to a resolution right then and there.
And then we said we weren't going to go to bed angry or mad or anything like that.
Yeah.
That was one of the things we said we were going to do.
And, it's been working. And your turn, babe, number three.
So number three, we had conversations about merging our lives together because we weren't naive. We knew that we was marrying, like you said, debt. We had a conversation about finances, but most importantly, we knew that our families, we were going to have to deal with our families. So our entire lives were getting merged together. So we had conversations in the infant stage of our relationship about families, which I think is very important. You need to know, how your family is going to be.
And about habits. For example, one bad habit that I had, I shopped every single week. Every single week, I had to buy something. And Andre let me know real quick.
Not every week.
Yes.
Now I ain't no warden.
Right. This is true.
However,
I'm very spoiled.
You need to use wisdom with your spending. That's a word. Y'all need to write that down. Use wisdom with your spending.
Yes. And then number four, which is one of my personal favorites, wise counsel.
Oh, yeah.
Counsel.
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 Come on,
country. We sought out wise counsel.
You country. Counsel. It's okay.
Number four, we sought out wise counsel.
Yes, we did.
Number four. Number four, we had accountability. And this was super important to me because I knew that I wanted to do the journey being accountable, right? So we were able to get wisdom from older couples that had been married for 20 plus years. Also younger couples that had been married for 4 or less years. Also people that were healthy in their single season where we're still able to grow in our man and womanhood. And one thing I think that's tricky that people don't talk about is that people automatically tell you, you know, yeah, make sure you go talk to some older couples and get some wisdom, some tools, some resources. That's true. And that's right. But also, for us, I feel like we got the best of both worlds in both sets of couples. The ones that were married for a couple of years and also the ones that were married for 20 plus years. I feel like we still got the same amount of wisdom and resources that we need to make our marriage healthy and whole and to ultimately flourish.
Yeah, and I just love the fresh perspectives that we got from both the older married couples versus the younger.
Yeah.
You know, you're able to kind of give the best of, you know, the new school and the old school.
And number five, we definitely want to hone on premarital counseling. Because I know that's kind of a topic that a lot of people don't want to go toward. But we definitely are one of those that are for premarital counseling. Because I think during that season, we were able to learn even more about each other.
Yep.
Past the conversations that we had. Because I think we had pretty good conversations. And we had pretty good standards in place to communicate and all that, but the premarital counseling just pulled a lot more out of us.
Yes.
And we were able to be raw because our accountability, which were our pastors, they asked hard questions.
Yes, and
they
held us accountable
and gave us assignments.
And the assignments, one thing I loved about the assignments, like they weren't just, you know, like little pity pat assignments.
Oh, yeah.
They were real assignments that made you really think, hey, this is what marriage is really about.
Right.
Like I remember one of the assignments we got, I thought it was so amazing. Like we had to make a plan. It wasn't like, just a 1-year plan. No, it was like, where do you see yourself in 1, 5, 10, and even, you know, 15 years. I think I stopped maybe at 10 though, but yeah, and you know, just being able to actually sit down and think that far, you know, not just living in the moment, not living in fluff, but really say, hey, this is the person I want to spend the rest of my life with. And of course, we give our plans to the Lord. Of course, we know every single thing, you know, we plan out. Yeah, but we give everything to the Lord and we trust Him with our vision and we allow Him to give us the plan and the vision that He wants us to execute here on earth. And the next thing we did is number six. We talked about how we would handle conflict.
How do we handle conflict?
Yes.
So for us, we definitely kind of at our beginning stages had standards. Mm-hmm. And we said we were going to communicate. And I think I said it earlier, you know, just having that trust there helped when we were able to, when we faced conflict, because we were able to communicate, hey, you know, I don't like a certain thing, or, you know, being able to be honest enough, because I think honesty is also very important to have in any relationship, whether it is platonic or if it's a marriage. You know, it needs, you definitely have to be able to be honest and be able to say, hey, I'm not feeling good, or I don't like this, or, you know, whatever the case may be.
Yeah, and when we say conflict, we're talking about any type of conflict. Conflict with each other, conflict with friends, conflict in family. We talked about what does that look like. For example, like keeping our marriage sacred. Like, that was one big thing we talked about. Also, tone and words we won't use to each other and not having serious conversations over text messages. We talked about all that dealing with conflict.
And number seven,
Andre's favorite.
Finances. I'm going to say it again. Finances.
Finances. Andre can talk about this for 20 minutes.
No, I'm not though.
But yes.
Yeah, but finances are very important. You need to make sure that you are strategic with how you budget.
Yes.
You need to make sure that you are able to pay your bills and have fun. But pay your tithes and pay your bills first. Then, you know, splurge on the rest.
Yes.
Splurge on the rest.
Yes. Andre, as you can see, he you know, he went in on the finance part. And, you know, to be honest, I'm glad he has been the same before and right now. He's always been super serious about finance. I know what Andre,
'cause I'm a wealth builder. Come on.
Come on, wealth.
All right.
But what Andre, I already knew. As soon as the money hit the account, it's going to the tithe. As soon as he gonna have all the bills on automatic draft. He's gonna send a spreadsheet and a text message chart over about everything that's getting spent. That's right. He's very organized when it comes to finance. He gonna say how much we gonna sow seeds, who we gonna give to this week, all that. Like, he gonna have
it strategically. And I'm gonna hold you accountable to that.
Yes. If you tell Andre, hey, I need $200 for hair, and the tip is this much, that's how much you need to have. He gonna be like, wait, you ain't say that. You didn't include every single thing. Right. His favorite thing is, I think it's from like Dave Ramsey or something, but it's like, you know, every dollar has a purpose. It needs an assignment. So
every dollar has an assignment. That's right.
Yeah. And one thing I love, that we're able to talk about finance. We're able to have open dialogue about, hey, we need to intentionally save this. Hey, we want to sow into this nonprofit. Hey, we want to sow into this person, this business. Hey, you know, we don't want to do 10% tithe this month. We want to do, you know, a little up our tithe this month. Hey, this is what we're going to do for offering. This is what we're going to do for first fruit. Like, I'm glad we're able to have those conversations, and you know, Andre to be so organized and, you know, the visionary of our household, and just, you know, strategically plan how every dollar will be spent and how it'll be used wisely.
Yeah.
And next, after that, number 8, personal growth. So even while we were dating and courting and engaged, we were still intentional about our personal growth. So we still cared about, you know, what our health was. We cared about, you know, things we were working on, education, career, our friendships, our family, our ministry, everything dealing with us. We still made sure those things were flourishing. We weren't just caught up in the stage of, oh, we together, the Buddha butterflies. Like, yeah, that's great. But we still focus on our own personal growth, because we know, yes, we have some assignments and some things that we have to accomplish together, but still separate, you know, we still have identity. We still, you know, have things that we want to, you know, accomplish. Personal growth is very important. So keep making strides and make sure you're succeeding in your own personal growth. Grow with the Lord, grow in your friendships, grow in your career, grow in your education, grow in entrepreneurship, whatever it is that you need growth in, keep on growing in that aspect, even while you're dating and engaged and all that good jazz.
And last but not least, come on, have fun.
Have fun. Enjoy. Make memories. Don't out to eat each other to death. Listen. I know.
She brought the adventure out of me. Because I'm telling you, I'm just being, you know, transparent. There's stuff that we did, you know, I never would have done had we not gotten together.
Yeah.
Like, she literally, you know, and she kept it very adventurous and, you know, allowed me to try new things. And, you know, I think that's what it's about.
Yeah. And going out to eat is fun. It's fine. Yeah. You know, listen, I love food. I mean, I'm pretty sure you can tell I love food. But yeah, like, I love food. I love trying new food, going to different restaurants. But it's so much more to do to life than just go out to eat. Yeah. So intentionally do new things. Have fun. Do new adventures. Spontaneous. Like, don't even do surprises. Like, keep it fun. Because that same intentionality that you do to date, to court, to pursue each other, to love each other, you're going to need it in your marriage. So whatever you're doing now, you're just going to carry that stuff over to your marriage. So that's why it's a growth process. The great thing about going to the altar, that engagement, that courtship process, is that it's a process of growth. It's an area where you can evaluate areas that need to be, you know, sharpened in different ways. And you can actually have real conversations like, you know what? I really can spice it up in the date night area. Or, you know, I can really spice it up in conflict. Whatever it is, you can really ultimately do it. And lastly, what we want to talk about is, we just have a few things marriage is not. Marriage is not a cure for loneliness.
Definitely. It's not going to cure your rejection.
Yes.
It's not going to cure your low self-esteem. It's not gonna be a space filler for, you know, the loss of friendships, relationships, whatever the case may be. It's not gonna fill that void. So you have to be, you know, if you're really wanting to go on the road to being married one day, you have to be intentional about taking care of yourself, being whole, being healed.
Yes, and ultimately falling all the way in love with Christ.
Yes.
Another thing, marriage is not your ultimate happiness.
Right.
Listen, God will sustain you.
Yeah,
you should have friends. You should live your life. All that. If you think that marriage is the height of your happiness, you'll be in for a rude awakening. Of course, your spouse should make you happy, make you laugh, enjoyable. Yes, it should be all that. But you can't use just marriage to be just your end-all, be-all of happiness.
Right. Number 3, marriage is not the height of your purpose.
Yes. Christians go wrong with this all the time.
Absolutely.
Because they think marriage is the end-all, be-all. They think marriage is the end of the story. But it's like, no. It's the beginning of something new, something amazing. You just have a purpose partner to do life with.
Yeah.
Marriage does not cure trauma.
No.
Yeah, I think
if anything, it's gonna add. I mean, it's not gonna add on to it, but it's gonna.
It's gonna bring some level of deliverance.
Listen, you think that thing, that thing's gonna manifest?
Yeah.
Like it reveal, it's gonna reveal itself.
Yeah.
And numbers, what is this? Number six.
Number five.
Number five. Marriage is not an idol.
Yes. Do not make your marriage an idol.
Do not.
Listen, God is a destroyer of idols. So don't put your marriage on a pedestal. Don't lift it up. Don't esteem it more than God. Your end all be all should be Christ at the end of the day. So marriage is not a cure for loneliness. Marriage is not your ultimate happiness. Marriage is not the height of your purpose. Marriage is not the cure to your trauma. And marriage is not an idol. Hopefully this video, you found some amazing tips that you can use on your journey in engagement and courtship. We pray that your journey to the altar is something amazing and that you actually take some time to grow and to be the spouse that you need to be the man and woman of God that you need to be.
Yeah.
Until next time, happily ever turners. Don't forget to have some act right.